Radio, we are heading into the chat room now with Nine's Matthew Wolfrey in Sydney and Nine's Brenton Raglis in Adelaide. Welcome to both of you.
Good afternoon.
First up today, the bushfires raging across New South Wales and Queensland. They have been making international headlines. Now an unlikely celebrity has weighed in with his two cents, slamming Australia's response efforts. Leonardo DiCaprio took to Instagram with a scathing attack, saying we're among the worst in the world for looking after animals and that our country's conservation efforts need a radical overhaul. Matt, we know he cares about the planet, but does he have the right to express his opinion, or should he just mind his own business?
Look, everybody seems to be getting involved and having an opinion on this lately, don't they? Every man and his dog. But look, if the Prime Minister wasn't going to listen to all of those ex-fire chiefs who came to him with their opinions the other day, I don't think he's going to pay much attention to Leonardo DiCaprio all the way over in Hollywood and what he thinks about the bushfire crisis. So, look, he can go on as much as he wants to on his social media and have a rant, but I don't think it's going to do much to really affect change here. You've seen lots of celebrities getting on board this bandwagon of hashtagging and posting bit dramatic pictures of the bushfires, but I think it's the politicians who need to be paying a bit more attention than others, that's for sure.
Yeah, some people making it a political issue. Brenton, what do you think about all of this?
Well, look, I love Leonardo, but I don't care for his sideline commentary, or, to be honest, much of the commentary that's going on around this. Not that I don't care what they're saying. What they're saying is very valid, very important. But right now, the fire experts, the fire chiefs that are dealing with the situation 24 hours a day, they're very, very preoccupied with the situation at hand. And there will come a time where those fire experts will need to sit down with the political parties and have a bushfire summit to discuss all the commentary that's going on at the moment. But right now, we're only at the start of the fire danger season, and already our fire crews are exhausted with what's been going on just in the last few weeks, and we've got months ahead. So, look, certainly in the cooler months of the year, there will be the right time to sit down and have this discussion. But there are so many other things. It's not just, the warming trend or the drought conditions. They are major contributors to this bushfire emergency. But, are we doing enough as far as fuel reduction programs? What about the number of people now living in high fire risk areas? What about the fact that some of these fires have actually been deliberately lit?
Oh, yeah.
Leonardo does make a really good point, though, that the innocent victims in all of this is our Australian wildlife, and sadly that is one of the real tragedies out of this situation.
Yeah, some of those pictures of the koalas, it's truly heartbreaking. But as you say, Brenton, the situation, the threat is far from over, so right now the residents and the fire crews, that's the last they need to be hearing, isn't it?
Correct.
Okay, next, it's known as social media, but is it having the opposite effect? A new study has looked at whether social media could be making people less outgoing and more introverted because they're more likely to communicate online rather than in person. Brenton, do you agree?
I do. I think this is a major, major issue for us in society at the moment. Social media is a great tool, but it shouldn't be our first line of communication. And all too often, we sort of get buried in our phones and it becomes this wall against other lines of communication. Take technology away. What are the communication tools we've been given with? We've got our hands to talk with. Mm-hmm. We've got our eyes, our ears, our mouth, our facial expressions. Take technology away. These were the things that we've been, given at birth to communicate with. And I reckon, I'm pretty sure that if we actually addressed the fact that we could talk more, engaging with each other face-to-face, that would actually reduce the mental health epidemic.
Yep.
It would certainly reduce the amount of loneliness we have in our society.
Yeah, that's it. I mean, researchers, Brenton, have said that there's a loneliness epidemic across Australia and that, technology is to blame, this social isolation caused by, our technology. And whilst it has revolutionise the world, mostly for the better, Matt, it's also not doing so great for people in loneliness.
Totally. You actually don't have to leave your house to communicate with people anymore, and that's the problem. You can sit on your couch all by yourself and still speak to people, but it's not really the same as when you go out and have a drink with friends or have dinner with friends and you really get to see them face to face. It's not the same as writing a message to someone or even FaceTiming someone on the other side of the country. It just isn't the same. It's also affecting the world of dating. Nobody will approach each other in a pub anymore because they have to have swiped right or left on Tinder first, and that's the only way people are meeting. So it's really minimising the dating pool. Everyone's too afraid because they haven't looked at what they've done on Facebook or had a stalk of them beforehand that they might just not like them on first meeting.
Yeah.
Love at first sight is dead.
Yeah, and it doesn't happen if you haven't put it on social media. Disney is about to launch its new streaming service, but it'll be tacking on warnings that will run before some movies that contain offensive elements, such as The Jungle Book, where monkeys portray African Americans as criminals, or Dumbo, where the crows play into racial stereotypes. Brenton, is it enough to put a disclaimer ahead of these films, or do you think they should be scrapped altogether?
Oh, look, I don't think they should be scrapped altogether. And if you do it for Disney movies, you probably might as well do it for half the movies that exist out there. I'd say half the movies are inappropriate out there. But, look, don't scrap them, because I think it's really important to use as an education tool for our children growing up. They need to know the culture that we've grown up with as adults
now.
And how much it's changed. So I think it's a great education tool. Don't scrap them. Sure, have a disclaimer. But I think it's still worthy to keep them on there.
Matt, some of these movies, they may be considered outdated by today's standards, but... you know, they're just kids' movies. Is this taking it too far?
Totally taking it too far. And look, sure, if you want to put the forward there, but scrapping them all together, I don't think so. Are you going to do the same to literature as well? Because if you look back at some literature and novels that you study in school, that's pretty outdated. Some of the things in Shakespeare and Othello, the way they talk about slaves, are we going to scrap Shakespeare from school literature classes as well now? Hell no, I say. I'm a huge Disney fan, and nobody has ever grown up badly watching Disney films is what I think. I think, you know, kids probably won't even notice those parts because that kind of racism doesn't exist in their lives anymore.
Did you even remember those things?
No, exactly. And it's once you point it out, you can see it. Yes, you can see that it's there in all of these things, but it's in lots of movies from back then. You're not going to show Gone with the Wind anymore and big film classics as well. Yeah. All of those things, not just Disney.
Yeah, and nursery rhymes too. You know, we're going to get rid of those.
Don't come for my Disney classics. Yeah. Like, that is a touchy point for me. I will fight till the death.
Now, study has revealed what Aussie kids really want to be when they grow up. Boys most often dream of becoming a professional sportsman, closely followed by a policeman, engineer or mechanic. And for girls, a school teacher tops the dream job list behind a vet, actress or dancer. Matt. Did you ever want to be a professional sportsman or definitely a dancer, maybe?
Yeah, definitely not a sportsman when it came to me, that is for sure. And once upon a time, probably a bit of a ballet dancer in there somewhere, but that dropped off the ranks pretty well. I think it's good for kids to dream outside of the box dreams and what they want to be when they're older before the harsh reality of life kicks in a little bit down the track and you realise they're not always so easy to obtain. Let them think that they can do it for as long as possible, is my belief.
Yeah, Brenton, I mean, Aussie kids, they have more chance of playing their favourite sports professionally than being a barrister, apparently, or a surgeon or an optometrist. What do you make of that?
Yeah, well, I have to say, who are the most unsung heroes? You know, the surgeons and the health professionals, emergency service workers. They're the real heroes.
It's hard to be a surgeon too. You've got to be super smart.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. But, you know, the way we treat our sporting heroes and the way people look up to them, it's not surprising that that's a career path that they're looking to choose. Hey, great news, though, for all the Year 12 students that are, you know, finishing Year 12 and not sure what they're going to do next, join the club. I had no idea what I was going to do when I left Year 12. And, in fact, you automatically enrol from 18, I reckon, into the age of 30, the university of life, where nothing is ever wasted. You try your hand at a dozen different things.
Yeah,
if it doesn't work,
it
doesn't matter. But, you know, I'm now 43. It's been 25 years since I finished school.
Not looking for a career change, Ben Brenton.
No, but I still have no idea what I'm going to do for the next 25. So
we'll work that out. All good. Now, finally today, imagine going on a holiday and coming home to find this. That's what happened to a man in Adelaide, his neighbour installing a giant water tank right next to his house. Brenton, the tank is 200 millimetres away from the boundary, so technically the neighbour is within his rights. What do you think?
Well, it's a bit crafty for starters doing it on while the other guy was away, his neighbour is on holidays.
Sneaky.
You come back and it is really sneaky. And if you see the amount of land that this guy had to work with where he could put the tank, I'm surprised that more consultation wasn't done. You know, you really want to, you know, uphold that connection there with the neighbours. So, look, it is before the council right now because apparently that tank is larger than what it should actually be. So, yes, the more to the story, I think.
Sorry, Brenton. Matt, do you think it should be removed?
Look, I don't know if it should be removed, but why don't you, like, talk to your neighbours? You know what you think you should do? Paint a nice mural on it and make it a nice feature out the front of your house or something like that instead. Make everyone happy.
A nice Disney mural, perhaps?
Yeah, exactly. A little bit of old-school Disney.
OK, you two will have to leave it there. Have a great weekend. Thanks for
you
joining
too.
Us.
Thank you.